Guys, so in this second and in the third lecture of the course, we are going to analyze the different components that are part of our radial grid that are necessary to perform our investigation also further on once we will be introducing the wind turbines. So let's start with the first, the most important component in conventional power system, which is the synchronous machine, and specifically the synchronous generator, so the machine that is operating as a generator. So what we are going to do now is that we are going to see into the different tabs in Power Factory the most important information for us, for our investigation. And afterwards we will be doing a few exercises. Just static analysis, so no dynamics at this point. So just to see under different load flow conditions how the machine and how is the system reacting according to the different values. So let's get into our radial grid as usual. I just open the model. I can close all these windows here. And we have, as always, our radial grid. So let's start by analyzing a bit further the synchronous machine. So if you click on it, then you will get prompt the most important information, the basic data, where you have, for instance, the type information. So the type of synchronous machine that is behind this synchronous machine element. Always remember this important characteristic of Power Factory, that we have elements and we have types, so we can have different elements that different synchronous machine elements that represent different machines, but all with the same electrical characteristic. That means all with the same type of synchronous machine. This machine is connected at this voltage level, and we can see in the type window the most important information that characterize the size of the machine. So this machine is a 600 MVA, 20 kilovolt, a power nominal power factor of 0.85 that brings to the nominal active power, which is 510 megawatt. And then the key value that is always relevant for our dynamics, especially the frequency dynamics, which is the acceleration constant that is related to the rotational moment of inertia of the machine. 10 seconds in this case, referring to the nominal apparent power. And then the machine has also had the different values that characterize synchronous machine, reactance and so on, resistance and so on. Then what do we have? The other important tab is the one that refers to the load flow. So under the load flow page, we can see different useful information. So in this case, we can see a flag that is telling us whether this machine should be the reference machine or not. In this case, since we just have one machine by default, this machine will be our reference machine. Then, as we explained in the previous exercise, we can specify whether the machine should be subject to its local voltage control or if it should be subject to an external station control, which is just a name for a voltage controller. Why this voltage station control is useful? It's useful because it gives us the possibility of controlling the voltage at different points in the node, and also it allows the possibility of sharing any kind of voltage regulation among different machines that, for instance, are connected to the same bus, and then we can divide the sharing according to nominal rating or individual power values. In this case, we just have one machine, that means 100% of the rating of the sharing is given to that machine. Keep in mind that, as Power Factory is stating here, as long as we have a station control, any other kind of local voltage control will be ignored because of the station control. As we mentioned last time, active power, it doesn't really matter what kind of value we put here, because Power Factory will just set the active power according to the necessary, in order to balance the necessary consumption and losses into the system. Of course, this is not, this can be used in case we have more machines into the system. Another important feature is actually the this tab that characterizes the operational limits of our machine. So we can see here, for instance, that our machine is allowed to produce down to 0 megawatt, so it can be completely deloaded, and it can go up to 500 megawatts, so very close to the nominal rating of the generator. And then, equally important, if not more important, the reactive power capability, which is visually represented by this chart. So this chart is telling us that according to a certain active power value that you see prompted here on the y-axis, the machine is capable of providing a certain amount of reactive power, so the value on the x-axis. And as pretty much all synchronous machine, it can be, it can supply, it's capable of providing way more reactive power into the system compared to the amount of reactive power that it can consume. Always careful, because when we talk about reactive power, it can be the definition is ambivalent, so consumption and production can always refer to capacitive and inductive, depending on how you look at that. So it's always useful to specify whether the machine is behaving as a capacitor or as an inductor. And specifically, we say that the generator will be producing reactive power if it behaves like a capacitor. So that's on the right side of the plane. While if it is on the left side, that means that it's behaving as an inductor, so it's consuming reactive power from the system. That's pretty much the most important information. So let's see a little bit further, what do we want to do now. So we want to make all these steps. So we are starting with a load consumption of 100 megawatt, and then we want to see what's changing into the system if we increase to 200 megawatt, 300 megawatt, and so forth. Specifically, we want to see what's happening to voltage, magnitudes, and angles in the different nodes in the grid. So that's the picture now that we have 100 megawatt. We have 100 megawatt here. As explained before, we are setting the generator to control the voltage at 1 per unit on this bus, on the load bus, and this voltage will be given the dignity of the slack bus, so the angle will be equal to 0 degrees. Voltages throughout the grid will keep on increasing going towards the generators, because the generator is supplying the reactive power that is necessary to the existing components, or the two transformers and the line up here, to compensate for their losses, the reactive power losses. At this point in time, both transformer and lines are ideal in the sense that they don't have any resistive element associated. They just have serious reactance. So let's see now what's going to happen if we increase the load to 200 megawatt. Let's reperform the load flow. As always, we are running a balanced load flow. So the first interesting information that we can see is that we doubled the amount of active power, and the value is equally matched by the generator because we don't have any active power losses. But you will notice that the reactive power increased actually 4 times. So it didn't double, but it increased 4 times. Why is that? That's because the doubling of the active power caused the doubling of the current flowing into the system. More current, that means that the reactive losses throughout the system increased 4 times. And of course, the generator is the one that is supplying all the necessary reactive power. You will also see that the voltage here increased much more. So it went from 1007 up to 1.03 as a reason, because we had a 4-time increase of reactive power. We can also see this information that are displayed on the single line diagram as a form in the form of a vector diagram here in this vector diagram plot. So we can see down here all the four buses with their voltages represented. So the voltage at the load, 1 per unit, 0 angle. The voltage right in front of the transformer, close to the load. On the other side of the line, that's the red curve. And on the generator, that's the black curve. Also the current, which is the green line down here. And let's spend a few words giving a comment to the current. You will see that the current is, of course, in phase with the voltage at the load. That's because the load is not consuming any reactive power. But the current, which is the same throughout the system because we just have series elements in the system, there is nothing shunt, is actually lagging compared to the generator voltage. And this is reasonable because in the end, the generator is actually supplying reactive power. So seen from the generator terminal, the rest of the grid is actually consuming reactive power. So it's an active load with a certain amount of reactive power that is necessary. So it makes sense that this current is actually displaced. It has a certain power factor with reference to the generator voltage. You will also see that all the voltage drops from the load up to the generator, they are of course all orthogonal to the current. Why? Because we just have resistive reactive element and no resistive elements at all. Let's see now what's going to happen if we change the load even further. We take it to 300 megawatt. Let's run the load flow again. Again, what we experience that of course the active power remain the same throughout the system, but of course the reactive power again increased much more. So at this point in time is 9 times the value that we had at the very beginning with 100 megawatt consumption, because now the current is 3 times more than at the very beginning. Of course, the voltages throughout the system will need to get even more displaced, both in terms of magnitude. So this one will be 1066 because it needs to move more reactive power, and also in terms of angle because we are increasing the active power flow throughout the system. So that means that the different voltages need to be displaced even further. And of course, we can see the same kind of information also in our vector diagram. You can see specifically here that the current got much larger. It's a 0.5 per unit on the generator basis. Okay, keep in mind that this value is telling us that it's equal to 300 megawatt. And then of course we have the always the load, the voltage at the load, which is always 1 per unit 0.0, and so on the other voltages that follow. Let's get further. So let's see now what's gonna change if we change the reference bus in the system. So if we are going to remove the reference bus, and instead of having with reference to the load, we just decide that it's gonna be empty. So what Powerfactory will do is that it will set the reference bus on the generator because that's our reference machine. You can see that the state of the grid hasn't really changed. You can see that the voltages didn't really change, current and power didn't really change. The only thing that changed is just the angles at the different buses. In term, the absolute values change, so that this one is 0 degrees and it's not 20 degrees anymore, and the other one is minus 20 degrees and not 0 degrees anymore. So that means that we just rotated the voltages, but the physical implication is hasn't changed. So it's the grid is always in the same state. We are just looking at the voltages from another point of view. Let's see now the following step. So let's remove the station control and let's see what's happening to the voltages. So the station control, that means that we open our generator, we go into the load flow and we reset also the station control voltage. You will see that at this point there will be the local controller that will set the voltage according to the value that we are deciding here, which is the one per unit. So we perform the load flow and we see now something quite interesting. So we see now that of course this voltage at the generator is now one per unit, and because as again as before we need to supply the reactive power that is necessary to the different components, that means that the final voltage at the load will be way lower. And actually if you see the absolute values, now we have the difference in terms of magnitude between this value and this value got larger than before. Why is that? That is because we are still consuming 300 megawatt at the load, but because of the lower voltage, we have a higher current at the load. That means that we have a higher current throughout the system. That means that we have a higher reactive power consumed by the different elements, and that is reflected by the fact that the generator now is supplying 131 megawatt. Let's see now a little bit the influence also of local reactive power consumption and generation at the load. So let's take our load value back to 100 megawatt. We see now that the situation of course got much better because of the lower amount of reactive power that is provided in the system. And let's change the values here. Let's take this value to 100 megavar. So what's happening now? It's happening again the same problem as before, that we are setting this voltage at one per unit and we want to supply this large amount of reactive power. That means that in terms of current, we are not moving that much current, that much more current compared to the previous case. And actually, if you remember the values, that is still less than the current that corresponds to the 200 megawatt of active power. But the problem now is that we are moving pretty much displaced current into the system. That is the consequence that it will determine an even larger reactive voltage drop, as you can also appreciate from the phasor diagram here. Let's also see what's happening if we restore the station control that we had before. So we take back our station control. So we want now to set back the voltage at one per unit here. And of course, what is the generator trying to do is doing its best in order to make sure that we have a voltage equal to one per unit down here. But again, we need to compensate for this large. We need to supply this large amount of reactive power. That means that we need to move a lot. We need to increase a lot the voltage at this point in order to make this reactive power flow possible. And this is also appreciated by the phasor diagram here. You can also see again the phasor diagram probably in a slightly better way if we also restore the reference bus back to the load as we had before, because now you can see much better the fact that the current at the load is 45 degrees lagging compared to the local voltage. Okay, that makes sense because we have 100 megawatt and 100 megavolt ampere. And you can see now that because of this displaced current, the voltage drop throughout the system is also not purely imaginary, but we also have a real part to take in account. That has the consequence that the voltage at the generator needs to be much larger. Let's see the final case where we actually reverse the reactive power. So we do actually have a strong capacitive effect on this bus. So what's happening now? Now we have actually the problem the other way around, because right now, in order to absorb, so to compensate for all this amount of capacitive reactive power on this load, we need to heavily underexcite our generator. That means that we need to pull down the voltage quite a lot at the generator bus. And keep in mind that the previous case was not acceptable from a steady state point of view, because the voltage was beyond the generally allowed plus 10% around the nominal value. But also this situation is not very good, because we are below the minus 10%, the nominal value. So both situations are actually not really acceptable. And that's pretty much the reason why there is this mantra that we have in the high power, high voltage system, that we don't really want to move around reactive power. So if possible, always try to produce and consume locally the necessary amount of reactive power. Try to move as little as possible reactive power into the system. I think that's enough for the synchronous machine. Then we can continue in the next video with the lines.